We're on a mission from God.
And now for something completely different.
This is Pastor Jolly John Lekumsky coming to you from Northfield, Minnesota.
And this is Pastor Matt Youngblood Clark coming to you from Ascension Lutheran Church in South St. Louis.
And this is
Wrestling with the Basics.
And you know, we usually have kind of a humorous introduction. Yeah, kind of little. I know. But anyway, we try to have something funny. But not this episode, because Matt and I both had some somber experiences over the last couple of weeks. Matt, yours was kind of a mixed emotion thing, kind of sad, but at the same time very joyful. Explain to the people what you've been doing the last couple of weeks.
Yeah, thanks, John. Sort of a bittersweet couple of weeks for the Clark family, because we took our son up to college. So this is his freshman year at Concordia University in Chicago. So this is the first time he's really kind of spreading his wings, leaving the house. So we are at least partially empty nesters. And for those who are listening, if you've experienced that before, saying goodbye to a child as they head off to school or join the military or enter the workforce, whatever the case may be, just move out of the house. You know, it's not always easy, right? We went up to Concordia in Chicago and got him all set up in his dorm room. He has a wonderful roommate, Josiah. Seems like a great guy. He's signed up for his classes, of course. He even knows a couple people from his high school here in St. Louis that are attending Concordia as well. So I think he's in great shape. It's a good fit for him. He loves the big city of Chicago, but yet the smaller Christian Lutheran campus. So that's all great. That's all great. He'll be fine. That's kind of the sweet part of dropping him off. The bitter part, again, was saying goodbye for my wife, Lisa, and I. The last thing they do, really, as you drop your kids off and then they head to the orientation, is there's a worship service together in the chapel on campus. And really, it's designed to be a service where parents and students say farewell to each other. We pray for the students and for their school year. Wonderful way to say goodbye, no doubt about it. The last hymn we sang was Go My Children with My Blessing. That's sort of a tearjerker of a hymn, but the last stanza really stood out to me, the words, I, the Lord, will be your father. I think that's a beautiful line. And it just was a reminder to me that, yeah, I'm Noah's dad, and thanks be to God for that special calling, and I'll continue to be his dad. But yet Noah's father in heaven is always there with Noah. His father in heaven is there with him on that college campus. So a good reminder to me, certainly, and hopefully a reminder to Noah, too, as he begins his time there at Concordia.
And you know, Matt, see, that is really the neat thing about going to a Christian college. If people wonder, well, why? Because my kid's going to get a good education wherever he goes. But, you know, I took my daughter Naomi to Eastern University there in Illinois. And trust me, there were no church services there.
Sure. Yep.
Love your kid. Give us the money. Be on your way. And it is. That's such a hopeful thing to remember. Okay, this is sad. I'm separated from my child, probably for the first time, maybe in their life. But the Lord is still with both of us, and the Lord is going to bring both of us back together again. Although you were telling me Noah's reaction to all this was a little different than yours, wasn't it, Matt?
Yeah, just a little. So yeah, after the service, you know, it's basically time to say goodbye. And my wife asks, well, Noah, do you want us to go back to your dorm room with you, make sure everything's set up and, you know, ready to go? And Noah's like, no, I don't think so. we can just say goodbye now. So anyway, we said our goodbyes there in front of the chapel, and then we were on our way. So, but you know, that's what you want, right, John? You want your ready to go and prepared. And I think Noah certainly is. It's a good fit for him. And we rejoice in that too.
and I'm going to tell you a secret. Probably later that night when he was all by himself, he probably was having a little tear too, because it's sad to be separated, but we don't want to show that in front of mom and dad, or certainly not in front of any of the other students.
That's for sure. Yeah. So, well, thanks, John. I will believe that.
No, that's, I remember, you remember when you went away, you were glad you were on your own, and it's exciting. And yet, a little homesickness there.
Exactly.
Too.
It's bittersweet. Yeah.
So our somberness is again, was kind of a bittersweet thing, because Lynn's father, Jerry Raymond, he passed away, at 96 years. Man, that's a lot more time most people get to be with their parents.
Wow. Yeah,
and so we were really glad that we had him that long. And yet you can't get over the sadness of knowing that I'm not going to sit down and have a beer with Jerry again. You know, Jerry and I were, we were the valedictorians of the Budweiser Brewery School.
That's impressive, John.
Yeah, we co-shared the valedictorian position. Of course, we're the only two people in the class. But anyway, so I'm going to miss doing stuff like that with Jerry. And you wanted to point out another thing about Jerry.
I was going to say, whether they know it or not, our listeners are going to miss Jerry too, John, because any good joke you heard here on Wrestling with the Basics was usually courtesy of Jerry. You would pass them John's way, and any jokes that were worth telling were usually from Jerry.
So I'll have to go dig out some of the older emails. We maybe have to bring some of those back. It's been a while. People won't remember them, hopefully. But you're right. I don't know what we're going to do for anything humorous anymore. Now that but you know, see, going back to that service again, see, that's the great thing, that there was hope given you by that word about the Lord being the Father. And that's the same, we still share the same Father with Jerry, and Jerry's just home, right? He's in the place prepared for him, and we'll be going home to visit him someday. I hope not soon. I got a lot of things I want to do here on earth yet, but it is kind of nice that we'll all be back together sometime in the future.
Yes. Reunited. Thanks be to God.
So you have a story that you wanted to talk to us about. It actually has kind of to do with this issue about going up to heaven and having eternal life. And what was that text that you wanted to deal with, Matt?
There's certainly some connections. We want to look at Luke chapter 13, beginning with verse 22. So Luke 13, 22 to 30.
And do you want me to read, or do you have some intro? It's about a door. Isn't it about a door?
I don't want to introduce this. So Jesus starts to talk about doors. So I thought, well, let's talk doors a little, John. Yeah. And especially famous doors. And what it takes.
And by the way, if you need a door, don't forget about Menards, where you get 11% rebate for every purchase.
Yes. Save big money at Menards.
That's right. Okay, good. So now we paid for this week's episode.
You're welcome, Gabe.
Segue those commercials in there. Yeah, so all right. The door, famous doors.
It was seamless, John. Well done.
That's right.
So famous doors. So yeah, famous doors. And you know, the thing with famous doors is not just anyone can walk through those doors. You got to be enough to get through the famous doors. So here's a famous one for you. 10 Downing Street in London, England. You know who lives there, John?
Well, see, I was going to say Sherlock Holmes, but no.
It's close.
I think it's the Prime Minister, isn't it?
The Prime Minister, Since 1735, the residence and the office of the Prime Minister. So, yeah, to get through those doors, you just don't let anyone in. You got to be powerful enough to get through those doors.
It might let you and me take a picture of the door, but we're not going through the door. No.
That's as far as we're getting. Yeah. I mean, yeah, even if we tell them we're, you know, the host of Wrestling with the Basics, I don't know. We might not still get in. Who knows?
No, they probably would throw us out at that point. There would be guards that would escort us off the property. Escorted.
That's exactly it. To the Tower of London. Lock them up.
That's right. That's the door we'd go through.
It's the only door we're getting through. But other doors too, you know, thinking about dropping off our son at college again, and to get through the doors of a college as a student, well, you gotta at least be smart enough, you know, test scores and GPA and all that kind of stuff. Thinking of the doors of places like West Point, right? The military academy, To go through those doors as a student, well, you got to be brave enough, you know, willing to serve our country in that special way. Here in St. Louis, we got Rankin Technical College too, you know, learning a trade, so valuable to our city and our community. And to go through those doors, I'd say you got to be hardworking enough. That is not easy.
Yep. No, that's then, not, and, that takes a lot of effort. Yeah.
Yeah, for sure. You know, in school and then also in the workforce. So another famous door, speaking of famous ones, I looked up 15 Central Park West in New York City. Maybe our listeners are familiar with that door, but I sure wasn't. It's an apartment building, one of the most expensive ones in the world, right across from Central Park. So to go through those doors, you got to be rich enough to get through those doors. So the point is, John.
Wait a second, Matt. I hear a theme. So in all these doors, you either have to be rich enough, you have to be hardworking enough, you have to be rich enough. Did I say that? You have to be powerful enough, you have to be smart enough, right? These doors, just not everybody could get through those doors. Is that what you're saying?
Exactly. That is exactly what I'm saying. You got to be enough. You got to be enough to get through those doors. Exactly. Okay. So what does that have to do with Luke 13? Okay, well, there's a guy who asked Jesus this question, just sort of an anonymous guy. And basically he's saying, hey, Jesus, who's going to get through the doors into heaven? You know, who's going through the pearly gates, right? So let's read about that. We'll hear the man's question, and then we're going to hear Jesus' answer. So the question is in verse 22.
He went on his way, that's Jesus, through the towns and villages, teaching and journeying toward Jerusalem. And by the way, I think it's important as you read through these chapters of Luke that you remember that. He's making his trip to Jerusalem to die on the cross, by the way. This is not just, you know, another vacation, but this is the final trip. Because he says some really hard things in these chapters of Luke.
Oh, yeah.
He gets kind of mean and nasty. But remember, he's going to the cross, and there's a reason why he's kind of being grumpy. And I think you're probably going to deal with that in your discussion here. But anyway, so here's the question. Someone came up to him and said, Lord, will those who are saved be few?
Yeah. So again, basically the question is, you know, just how wide are the pearly gates, Jesus?
Yeah.
How many people are getting through into heaven? You know, the way to salvation, how big is it? So, you know, I think we can kind of presume that the man here assumes that, that not many are getting through. Yeah, that he wants Jesus to confirm his assumption that, yeah, those who are going to be saved are few. And, you know, more than likely, he considers himself to be among the few that are getting through. You know, he is enough to get through those pearly gates.
I haven't read this in a while, Matt, in the Greek, but as I remember, the grammar of it is such that he's actually saying, it's true, isn't it, that not a lot of people are going to be saved. And like you said, I'm assuming that he thinks that he will be amongst those few, yeah.
Yeah, so he wants Jesus just to confirm what he's thinking. And, you know, Jesus kind of does. He gives an honest answer here, maybe a surprising one for us too. So if you'd like to read Jesus' answer in verse 24.
Strive to enter through the narrow.
Go ahead, John. I'm sorry.
Okay. Strive, which right away that says it's not going to be easy, right? If you have to strive for something, it's got to be kind of hard to enter through the narrow door. For many, I tell you, will seek to enter and will not be able. So you're absolutely right. Only a few will be saved because it's just too narrow.
Yeah. So the door is narrow. Not everyone who seeks center will be able to.
And no again, fat guys. No fat guys are getting in.
No fat guys. Okay. No fat guys.
Yeah.
All right. taking this a different direction, John. But
okay.
We might return to that idea, though. So Jesus, I think it's important to say what he's not saying here. Okay. Jesus is not saying that he only wants a few people into heaven. You know, he's not saying that he's hoping there's only a few people going through that narrow door. No, Jesus came to, as he says, to seek and to save the lost. I mean, that's his desire. That's what he's on mission to do. But he also acknowledges the reality that, some will sadly choose not to enter. And we see that in his ministry too. Some reject his word. You know, speaking of going to Jerusalem, is when he gets there, they're going to yell for his crucifixion. So Jesus acknowledges reality that, the door to salvation, it is narrow. Only a few are going to enter.
And you know, going back to what you say, to seek and to save the lost, you know, the crazy thing is, God even wants people that we think shouldn't go through the door to go in, right? Yeah. What's he say? I don't even desire the death of the wicked, but that they would repent and be saved. That is, walk through the door, the narrow door. But it's still a narrow door.
We'll see that. Yeah, exactly. I think we think, well, what about us? Are we among those who are going to be going through this narrow door, Jesus?
Good question,
And I think when we ask that question, we start to look at ourselves and think, well, am I enough? You know, am I powerful enough, rich enough, brave enough, hardworking enough? And maybe most of all, am I good enough? You know, we have a perfect, holy God. Am I good enough to get through that door? Have I kept the Ten Commandments well enough, for instance? Have I trusted in God enough? Have I honored Jesus' name enough? Have I remembered the Sabbath day enough? Have I honored my father and mother enough? You know, we go on down the list. And I think what we begin to see is, well, no, we're not enough. In fact, our sin is so big that we can't fit through the narrow door. On our own, we are just not enough.
We are too large in our sinfulness. Yeah,
that's right. So here's a story. So this is a story I found from a Lutheran pastor from Chuck Schley is his name. I don't know him, but he tells this. I won't tell the whole story word for word, but he tells a story about going on a field trip with his grade school age daughter and her class, and they went to Mark Twain Cavern, the cave, Hannibal, Missouri. Maybe you've been there.
I've been there. All right.
Well, good. So he's there, and he's talking about how he began to get nervous, and you know, he's like, "Well, why? You know, I'm the chaperone. I shouldn't be the one that's nervous." And he says he's got to be the big dad, right? He's the one who needs to be brave. And he says, "Well, the dad part wasn't what made him uneasy. It was the big part."
Yes. I've been to the cave. I know what he's talking about.
So he says halfway through the tour, the guide, he stops the group and he says, up ahead, we're going to turn the corner and there's going to be a bit of a tight squeeze. The narrowest part of the cave, and they call it Fat Man's Misery. So then he says his daughter looked at him and started kind of sizing him up. Like, Dad, are you going to fit? Oh boy. So anyway, they get, you know, he looks at the opening and then he looks at the tour guide, you know, wondering if he's going to fit through it. And when he looked at the tour guide, finally he could be confident. He was put at ease. You know why? Because the tour guide was bigger than him.
Bigger than he was. There you go.
So the tour guide, if he's leading him through, it's going to be okay. And, you know, the point that he makes, and I think it's a good one, is, well, that's who we turn to. We turn to our guide. We turn to, you know, someone who's more than a guide, right? Our savior, right? Yeah. He's bigger than we are. He knows the way. And it makes me think of John 14, you know, where Jesus says, you know, do not let your hearts be troubled. I'll kind of paraphrase here, John. You know, I'm going ahead of you. Don't be afraid. In my Father's house, there's many rooms. I'm going to go prepare one for you. And then, of course, he says, you know, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So if Jesus has already blazed the trail for us, he's already gone through the narrow door, and looking to Jesus in faith, well, that's how we enter through that narrow door, looking to our Savior who's already gone the way for us, the one who is the way, not only knows the way to heaven, but is the way to heaven. Most certainly too. So I think that was kind of a neat story and a neat way of looking that, we don't have to be afraid. We don't have to, you know, worry about how big our sin is, because our Savior is far bigger than even our biggest of sins.
And you know, Matt, that story that you told, that really strikes home to me, because I had the exact same experience.
Really?
But in my case, they had to cover me in lard to get me to slip through that. But, you know,
It's whatever it takes,
you know. But so now it actually brings us back to why Jesus. Were you going to read? Because you know, you read on here. This is really not very nice stuff. Because he goes on and says, you know, many are going to seek and they're not going to be able. And he talks about the fact that you know, you're going to knock on the door and I'm going to say, I don't know who you are. Get away from here. There'll be weeping and gnashing of teeth. And yet the thing is that the reason why Jesus is being so mean is because there's only one thing we have to get through that door, and that is to realize that we can't get through the door.
Yeah, isn't that ironic? Yeah, I know. And that's exactly right. To repent, you know, of our sin, to realize it, and to look to Christ, right? The one who can is the way through that narrow door. So, yeah, I think you're right. You know, he goes on and he talks about the door's going to be shut, people are knocking and opening to us, and he'll say, I don't know you. But I think even those words are said out of love, you know, that Jesus is really emphasizing the urgency of this. Again, he's on the way to the cross, right? His time is growing short, you know, during his earthly ministry, at least. And he's warning people that, no, this is urgent. This is the reality. To just say, like he says, hey, you ate and drank in our presence. You taught in our streets, Jesus. We kind of know who you are. That's not enough. No, it's not just this knowledge of who Jesus is, but it's knowing that Jesus is my Savior, that his death, his resurrection is all for me, right? And to know that in faith. So I think of, you know, for us too, it's not too late, okay? And it's not too late for those in our families and circle of friends who maybe don't know Jesus Christ as Savior. It's not too late. The door is still open, okay, for now. But boy, there's going to come a time where it's closed, you know, certainly when we die, certainly it is return. So now is the time to share Christ that way. With those around us.
And so, Matt, there are some people who would want to say, oh, well, everyone will be saved, right? And anybody can get into heaven. And the scary thing is, see, that's not true. But unlike the man in our text who wanted to say, oh, yeah, not everybody can get into heaven, but of course I can, a few can. No, because what the Bible teaches is that nobody's going to get into heaven, not on their own. And that's the big problem. If you think you can just waltz in there, you're going to be the fat guy. And I'm sorry, I don't care how much lard they put on you. You're not slipping through. You're just not.
Yeah, that's right.
Because the sins are too great. But see, there you go. So then, like you said, then comes the realization, but Christ has done it all.
Yeah.
You know, and with Christ, all of a sudden, it's not a narrow door. It's the broadest door there could be. Even the wicked will walk through that door. Even people like Peter, who denies him three times, walk that door. Yeah. Or the apostle Paul, who actually actively persecuted Christians, will walk through that door. But it's not easy. It's not easy. Yeah. But with Christ, it's possible.
Yeah, on our own, we're never enough. And yeah, just to finish up with those final verses, verses 28 and following, you know, Jesus says who's going to be there? Who's going to be through that door? Who's going to be in that kingdom of heaven? Well, he says Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and the prophets. But then in verse 29, he goes, and people come from the east and west and north and south and recline a table in the kingdom of God. And then he says, behold, some who are first will be last and some who are last will be first. So I think that's interesting. So yeah, who's going to enter through that narrow door? Well, some of the people we expect, right? We got Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, you know, those you know, heroes of the faith, right, in the Old Testament. They'll be there. But then Jesus says there'll be people from all over the place, north, south, east, west. Those who are last will be first. You know, so the point is, you know, that who's going to be, you know, through those pearly gates? Who's going to enter through the narrow door? It's not just the people who are powerful enough or smart enough or hardworking enough or wealthy enough or good enough even. In fact, that's not who's going to be there at all. It's the people for whom Jesus is enough. Jesus is enough. No matter who you are, no matter what you've done, Jesus is enough for us to enter through that narrow door. He's the only way through that narrow door. And like you said, John, and in that respect, well, yeah, it becomes broad, so to speak, right? Because, yeah, anyone, even the last people you'd expect to be there are there because, again, for them, Jesus was enough. And that's all we need.
And the irony is, though, even though the door is narrow, the answer to the question, will a few be saved, is no, not a few, many, many, from the east and west and from the north and south.
Yeah. So by God's grace, many will be saved. And, you know, we look forward to that reunion in heaven where we'll see Jerry, right? You know, your father-in-law.
Yes.
And those many for whom they weren't enough, but Jesus was enough. And that's how they've entered. And that's how we, by God's grace, will enter too.
This has been Wrestling with the Basics.